Okay. Hashtag BW Mormon 2015. Final word. That's right. So let me lay out the format for our sessions. The first session, Race in the Inner City, is designed to teach us about the historical roots of segregation, urbanization, faith-based social justice, and the intersection of Mormonism with those forces. It will create a big picture overview for the remainder of the panels. Race and Mormon Women is next, and then Race and the International Church, our lunch session with Elder Joseph Sitati of the LDS First Quorum of the 70. This lunch session is unfortunately filled to capacity. It will be held in the Great Hall here at the Utah Museum of Fine Arts for those of you who registered in advance. I will give instructions before we break for lunch. If you are not registered in advance, I will also then give some suggestions for places to eat here on campus before we break for lunch. And I do apologize. We tried to accommodate as many people as possible for that lunch. In the afternoon, beginning at 2, we will gather again in this room and explore race at BYU and then race at the ward level. So our first panel today is the token white male panel. Every conference needs one, and this is ours. I am thrilled that each of our panelists agreed to join us. We envision this panel as the big picture overview for the rest of the conference. It will establish the historical, social, and racial context within which the rest of the panels will take place. It is designed to teach us about race, social justice, segregation, and the Mormon intersections with each of those. Dr. Thomas Sugrue will teach us about the historical development of what he calls the urban crisis. Dr. Ram Cnaan will share with us his work on social justice efforts in inner city religious communities, including those of the Latter-day Saints. And Dr. Jacob Rugh will help us to understand what race, segregation, and urbanism have to do with Mormonism since 1978. Dr. Thomas Sugrue recently joined New York University as professor of social and cultural analysis and history after 24 years at the University of Pennsylvania. Educated at Columbia, Cambridge, and Harvard, he is a 20th century U.S. historian who has published on a wide range of topics, including the history of American cities, civil rights, liberal and conservative politics, labor, ethnicity, race, and public policy. He is past president of the Urban History Association and the Social Science History Association, and a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and the Society of American Historians, and an inaugural Carnegie Fellow. Sugrue's first book, The Origins of the Urban Crisis, won the Bancroft Prize in History, the Philip Taft Prize in Labor History, and the President's Book Award of the Social Science History Association, and the Urban History Association Prize for Best Book in North American Urban History. His second book, Sweet Land of Liberty, The Forgotten Struggle for Civil Rights in the North, is the first comprehensive history of the African-American freedom struggle outside the South. It was a main selection of the History Book Club and a finalist for the Los Angeles Times Book Prize in History. We asked Dr. Sugrue to draw upon his scholarship to teach us about the historical roots of racial segregation in America's urban centers. We are fortunate to have him here, and I look forward to his remarks. Dr. Ram Cnaan is a professor and director of the Program for Religion and Social Policy Research at the University of Pennsylvania, School of Social Policy and Practice. Professor Cnaan is the past president of ARNOVA, Association for Research on Nonprofit Organizations and Voluntary Action. He received his doctorate degree from the School of Social Work at the University of Pittsburgh and his BSW and MSW from the Hebrew University, Jerusalem, Israel. Professor Cnaan is the author or editor of 8 books, including The Other Philadelphia Story, How Local Congregations Support Quality of Life in Urban America. He is considered an international expert in the areas of faith-based social care, volunteering, prisoners' reentry, and social policy. The title for his talk today is Race in the Inner City, American Religious Congregations and Social Services Provisions. And Dr. Jacob Rugh is an assistant professor in the Department of Sociology at Brigham Young University. Raised on Chicago's South Side in both segregated Woodlawn and more integrated Hyde Park, his childhood traced the growth and diversification of his church congregation from a small branch in the late 1970s to a thriving majority-minority ward by the 1990s. Black leaders such as Kathy Stokes and Hattie and Victor Soil cared for him in nursery, presided on the stand, served with his parents, and left a lifetime impression on his ideals of faith, the universality of the gospel, and the moral imperative of racial equality. He and his wife have also served in Harlem, New York, and in Spanish-speaking congregations in central New Jersey. As a result of living on both sides of America's color line, Dr. Rugh strives to forge a more racially integrated and just society by focusing his research and teaching on racial segregation in housing, discrimination in lending, and contemporary immigration. His research has been published in the American Sociological Review, Du Bois Review, Social Science Research on Race, Social Forces, and several other peer-reviewed journals. His findings on racial segregation and the foreclosure crisis were highlighted in a recent influential article in The Atlantic magazine. He has served as an expert in multiple fair lending cases. His research has been integral to a recent successful settlement in a key civil rights housing case on behalf of victims of discrimination. The title of his presentation is Growth of the LDS Church in Urban Areas Since 1980, Why It Happened and Why It Matters. So we will start with Dr. Tom Sugrue.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Paul, for the kind introduction. And I also want to thank Paul and Dalen for making it possible for me to come here. This is my first trip to Utah, and my one true disappointment, other than not being able to sing my paper, is that I have to leave tomorrow morning, so I'll need to come back at some point in the future. As a 20th century historian of cities and civil rights, I have written about the intersections of race, civil rights, religion, and cities in any number of different ways. I've written about Catholic parishes and the role that they played in the racial division of American cities. I've talked about Jewish congregations and how they often fled racially changing neighborhoods in advance of African Americans moving in. I've talked about liberal Protestants who, in many respects, were on the vanguard of the struggle for civil rights, particularly in the North in the middle of the 20th century, working through churches, through sermon guides, and through their publications to raise a consciousness of their members. I've talked about, of course, the African American church and its central role at the vanguard of the movement, both in terms of ministerial leadership, but especially in what we could call the pew roots struggle led by ordinary African Americans, often not household names, who were the troops in the army wielding their battle axes against against racial injustices. But I didn't know and hadn't really thought at all about the ways in which my scholarship intersects or connects in any way with Mormon history. But now, with the challenge of talking at this conference and looking back, I realize that in an interesting way, it has. And the connection is kind of obvious. Let me begin with a story involving America's most famous mid-20th century Mormon, who happened to walk across the pages of pretty much everything that I've written, even if he was buried away in a footnote. He was in Detroit in the period that was covered by my first book. He was central in civil rights battles in the 1960s in my second book, and he figures in my newest book, just published about a week ago, A Sweeping History of 20th Century America, where I discuss his involvement in the Nixon administration and its housing policy. That famous Mormon, of course, is George Romney. In January of 1963, just 2 days after George Romney was inaugurated the governor of Michigan, he attended the Metropolitan Conference on Open Housing in Detroit. The Metropolitan Conference was a group of black and white activists challenging the deeply entrenched patterns of racial segregation in housing markets in places like Metropolitan Detroit. There, new Governor Romney, announced his support for civil rights legislation that forbade racial discrimination in housing. He was, of course, already one of the leading figures in the Republican Party, although I should say it's a very different Republican Party in 1963 than it is today. George Romney, I think in many respects, would in today's current political spectrum, probably plopped down somewhere in the middle of the Democratic Party, but at that time he was in the mainstream of the Republican Party. He was, of course, at this moment already considered presidential material, both for being elected as governor of one of the country's most important swing states, and because of his leadership as a chief executive of a major corporation, American Motors. But George Romney walked into the governorship of Michigan right at a crucial moment in his city, his state, and the nation's history of civil rights. And he waded right into one of the most controversial, perhaps the single most controversial aspect of the civil rights struggle in the North, and that was the connection between racial segregation, housing, and education. And he did it mostly unflinchingly. Romney was not just playing to his audience of liberal civil rights activists at that open housing conference. And in fact, his message was quite consistent to very different audiences. I discovered a little nugget in the archives when I was doing research a few years back of Governor Romney that same year addressing a luncheon of the Northwest Detroit Board of Realtors. The realtors, nationally, had launched a campaign against civil rights laws that forbade discrimination in housing. They placed ads opposing civil rights laws in local newspapers and national magazines. They printed and widely disseminated brochures and pamphlets about their position on civil rights that they sent to church organizations, to chambers of commerce, to anyone who would be willing and sympathetic to their message. They also very effectively lobbied at the state level, at the city level, and at the national level, keeping the question of race and housing off the agenda. Indeed, just as a quick aside, the Civil Rights Act of 1964, the most important piece of civil rights legislation since Reconstruction, did not include anything about housing because of the fact that it was still very much a controversial issue, and some of the most influential lobbying groups, including the National Association of Realtors, was opposed to even the mention of housing in that legislation. So that realtors had done something which became commonplace in the rhetoric about race and civil rights. They were pioneers, which is they did not couch their opposition to civil rights legislation in terms of their animosity towards African Americans. Rather, they wrapped themselves in the mantle of color blindness. For the realtors, housing segregation was the natural consequence of the sum of individual choices in a free market. Civil rights policy was an unwarranted extension of the power of government into relationships, into transactions that should be left to private individuals. They went further and based their argument in the founding documents of the United States. They argued that civil rights legislation that would tell homeowners whom they could sell their houses or rent their houses to, would tell real estate brokers to whom they could show houses, that this was a violation of the freedom of association. It was a violation, an infringement of some of the most basic freedoms that defined what it meant to be American. So in this context, George Romney went to speak to the Northwest Detroit Board of Realtors. Many at the luncheon that day had voted for Romney. Some of them had given money to his campaign. And when he made essentially the same speech that he had made to the council, the conference on open occupancy, he was greeted by stone silence by the realtors. They did not applaud at the end of his lunchtime address. When Governor Romney spoke to the realtors and when he spoke out on these issues, he received reams of correspondence. I have leafed through some of it, and journalist David Marinus, a Pulitzer Prize winning author who's just done a book on Detroit, very conveniently leafed through some just recently. He received angry letters from his constituents, from some of the elites in Detroit, and from some members of the LDS Church, some saints. One, Don Brunner, a lawyer, an LDS member, wrote to Governor Romney, and I'm going to quote this at length because it's very interesting. "We feel that you have deserted the teachings of your church, of which you are a holder of the Melchizedek priesthood, in a cheap effort to further your political career. How many Negro priesthood bearers do you have in your ward? All of this, Brother Romney, presents manifold the opportunity for mixed marriages and of white children who are forced to give up all of their endowments in the church that their one white parent entitled them to because they have some small part of Negro blood in their veins. Hard words for Governor Romney. Romney mostly did what politicians do and dispatched the answering of his letters to his aides, but he decided to write back to Brother Bruner directly. Dear Brother Bruner, Romney wrote, you will find that the first section of the Doctrines and Covenants makes it clear that the revelations of the gospel were for all. Furthermore, the Book of Mormon makes it clear in several places that God is no respecter of persons, and his plan of salvation is for the people of all colors, both black and white. I am fully aware of the church doctrine, and I know nothing in our church doctrine that denies Negroes or anyone else full rights as American citizens. He didn't mention, of course, the priesthood, the subject of last night's really interesting talk. But nonetheless, you could say that Governor Romney was schooling one of his fellow saints in the doctrine of the church. Well, Governor Romney is not going to be the subject of most of the remainder of my talk, but I wanted to use him as a way of setting the stage, of looking at the ways in which the kinds of questions that Romney was speaking about and responding to in mail were central to the history of American politics, of everyday life in the middle of the 20th century. And Governor Romney was serving in political office and grappling with these issues in a state and in a city that were among the most racially divided in the entire United States. Solving the problems of racial inequality in his home state, Michigan, and in his native city, Detroit, or his adopted city, Detroit, proved to be immensely challenging because racial inequality was baked into the fabric of everyday life in Michigan, Detroit, and dare I say, even in Romney's ward. For the next few minutes, I want to talk about the ways in which the history of race played out in Romney's city and state, and talk a little bit about the responses to it, and come back briefly to Romney at the end. And I'm going to ruthlessly compress to stay within my mandate to talk for just 20 minutes. The conventional narrative about race and cities is one that you've all heard. Despite the fact that now a whole generation of scholars have challenged it, it remains very deeply entrenched in how journalists and how policymakers, how politicians think about race and inequality in cities in America today. It goes something like this. The United States was moving inexorably towards racial progress. We love stories of progress in the United States. They're central to how we define ourselves. We were moving inexorably towards racial progress until the dramatic changes of the 1960s and 70s. The argument, and it's a familiar one, goes something like this. An overgenerous welfare state, embodied in Lyndon Johnson's War on Poverty, took away people's incentives to work and subsidized family breakdown and dysfunction. Angry black power advocates alienated otherwise well-meaning whites through their divisive rhetoric. The urban riots of the 1960s destroyed inner cities, leading to mass white flight and disinvestment. A left-leaning version of this argument, denying what I just suggested, focuses on the 1970s and says everything was great until the globalization and flight of jobs out of the United States. Romney's Detroit stands as a case study for these explanations. Detroit was a major recipient of anti-poverty measures in the Johnson administration. It was a site of one of the most violent riots in 20th century American history. It was home to a militant civil rights movement and a black power movement. It elected one of the nation's earliest black mayors, Coleman Young, who was immensely controversial. And still today, it is one of the most racially segregated metropolitan areas in the United States, at the very top, indeed, usually in the top two or three. If it were only that simple. In my own research, years of fastidious research in newspapers, public records, census data, corporate publications, religious publications, the records of civil rights groups and city agencies, and labor unions and corporations and so much more, I discovered a very different story, one that helps us to understand Romney's world in 1963. By the time that Governor Romney came to office in January of 63, way before the riots, way before the rise of black power, way before the election of an African-American mayor, way before the flight of American jobs to Japan and Germany and other parts of the world, Detroit and many other American cities like it were already deeply divided by race and suffering massive economic woes. Three major changes, each of them devastating, each of them having a significant effect on African-Americans, transformed our cities in that period. First, the flight of industry, way before there was competition with other parts of the world, when the United States was at its peak of economic power. Second, persistent workplace discrimination, despite civil rights gains. Third, and most important, and what I'll spend most of my time on, persistent housing segregation. Let me look at each of these really quickly, the two super fast, the third in a little more detail. The flight of jobs and capital. In the 9 years before Governor Romney became governor of Michigan, Detroit lost 134,000 manufacturing jobs. This is before any American has ever heard of Toyota or Honda or BMW. It's at a moment when the American auto industry is at its peak. Companies are leaving Detroit and other big cities around the United States in this period in search of cheap labor, in search of suburban greenfields, in search of markets in other parts of the country, and that's devastating. At the same time, major manufacturers and all sorts of industries are introducing new automated technologies that are essentially replacing people with machines. Who is affected by that? Overwhelmingly African Americans, who have migrated to the city in big numbers seeking economic opportunity, who've moved into the entry-level jobs that are the ones that are precisely disappearing. The auto industry and most other American industries aren't moving randomly across the landscape. They're moving to mostly white communities, leaving African-American migrants who are seeking jobs with fewer and fewer opportunities. That's the job flight in a nutshell. Discrimination. African-Americans made huge gains during World War II and immediately thereafter because of civil rights protests and got jobs to an unprecedented number. But they still faced really significant obstacles. I could give you lots of examples of that, but let me just give you a couple statistics from the years right up leading to Romney's election as governor. In 1960, only 67 out of General Motors' more than 11,000 skilled workers were black. It's not because there weren't black skilled workers there. There were a lot of black skilled workers, but they couldn't get those kinds of unionized, well-paying, skilled jobs. In 1963, Romney's first year in office, the Ford Motor Company provided a list of all of its white-collar occupations open up to African-Americans. There were a few hundred jobs altogether, and the list included porter, valet, security guard, mail clerk, and telephone operator. Not the kinds of white-collar jobs that provide advancement up the economic ladder. Discrimination, despite the gains of civil rights, was still pervasive. But by far the most vexing issue for Governor Romney, why he made it such a focus early in his administration, and for metropolitan areas in the United States, was racial segregation in the housing market. Over the course of the 20th century, metropolitan areas, including Romney's Detroit, grew intensely segregated by race. That was not inevitable. It was not the sum of individual choices. There was not a free market in housing, despite the realtors' rhetoric to the contrary. Over the course of this period, there were interacting forces that created deeply segregated metropolitan areas. Real estate practice, federal housing policy, and grassroots homeowners resisting the movement of blacks into their neighborhoods. A little more detail. When realtors, the subject of my next book, I should say, when realtors professionalized in the 1920s, they had a code of ethics. That code of ethics included not introducing incompatible elements into neighborhoods, including members of an undesirable racial or ethnic group. That code of ethics remained in practice. Indeed, the National Association of Real Estate Boards, whose chapter Romney spoke to, had no African-American members until the 1960s. Blacks were not included in the mainstream real estate industry at all. Realtors played an active role in steering African-Americans to black communities and whites to white communities and maintaining the racial divide and making it seem as if it were natural. That did not go away with the passage of state and federal legislation forbidding discrimination in housing. Indeed, a lovely real estate agent who showed me my first home in Northwest Philadelphia in the mid-1990s told me euphemistically to do my neighborhood research when I was looking at a house on a street that was mostly African-American. She could not say, because it was illegal and she was smart enough not to break the law, that black people were living there. Rather, she suggested that me, historian / sociologist, go out and do my own. Real estate brokers are central. Federal housing policy is next. During the end of the Hoover administration and the New Deal, the federal government transformed America's housing market, making it possible for tens of millions of Americans to own their own homes. Most of you who own homes have 30-year mortgages. You put 10% down, maybe 20% down. That is a system created in the 1930s through the Homeowners Loan Corporation, the Federal Housing Administration, and the Veterans Administration. In 1930, a minority of Americans owned their own homes. By 1960, about 60% of Americans own homes. Today, it's somewhere between 60 and 70% for whites. It's about 75%, even after the financial crisis. Those federally backed mortgages and loans that made possible mass home ownership had one really significant proviso. They did not go to people who were living in racially mixed neighborhoods. They did not go to developers who built for mixed use. And they did not go to African Americans who wanted to live in predominantly white neighborhoods. These policies baked into law discriminatory attitudes and practices, including those by real estate brokers. Finally, there was a mass movement of homeowners. In Romney's Detroit, real estate agents worked closely with white neighbors to create, between 1945 and 1965, more than 200 neighborhood associations. These were civic associations that were meant to create solidarity and friendliness. They did picnics, they hosted events, but their primary goal was to maintain the racial homogeneity of their neighborhoods. Homeowners associations led the drive to repeal a Detroit referendum. This also happened in California, it happened in Ohio and elsewhere. They led a referendum to repeal the city's fair housing ordinance that had been passed in 1964. Likewise, these homeowners associations engaged in pickets and protests against every African American who moved, the first or second who moved into all white neighborhoods. I found more than 200 incidents of attacks on African Americans who were the first or second to move in. This included trucks putting chains on and pulling down pillars on front porches. It included arson. The most common was window breaking with stones because you could do it under the cover of darkness. All of these summed together to create a climate that said to African Americans, we don't want you in our community. The combination of all of these things, interacting with each other, occurring simultaneously, laid the groundwork for the crisis that faced Detroit when Governor Romney spoke to the Open Housing Conference and to the realtors. However, challenging these manifestations of racial inequality proved to be incredibly difficult. The primary goal of civil rights activists in the middle of the 20th century was to change the hearts and minds of white Americans, to persuade whites that they should see African Americans as their equals, as their peers. To some extent, they succeeded. If you were to go to a community meeting in most of the United States in the 1940s, white people would regularly drop the N-word. They would regularly express their prejudices publicly. By the 60s and 70s, not so much. However, there's a change in attitude, but not a change in the everyday institutions that affected white and African American relations. That was the housing market, the employment market, and the way that people lived in metropolitan America. As we look out onto the cities today, and come back for a moment in my last comment on Governor Romney, Romney, who was not by any means a perfect man, he didn't have much to say about racial discrimination in the workplace. It wasn't a central issue for him. Romney knew that to change the patterns of racial segregation that determined your access to schools, your access to jobs, your access to public goods and services and resources did not simply require changing the hearts and minds of Americans. It demanded changing their institutions. In the early 1970s, he swam against a huge tide as head of housing and urban development in the Nixon administration, and he lost. He lost because changing institutions proved to be the unfinished business of the civil rights struggle of the 1960s, and it remains today still the unfinished business. Thank you.
Morning. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Good. Good morning. It's very difficult. It's a tall order task to go after Tom. So I'll do my best. This was one of the most difficult lectures to prepare. I'm invited quite a lot to give talks around the country, abroad. And preparing this lecture was a very difficult task, and I'll explain it in a few minutes in more detail. And I actually took notes while Tom was talking and kind of changed some directions. It's an unfinished presentation. And I'll have lots of things to say. This is a topic I can talk for 2 hours. It will be even more interesting than 20 minutes. I ask Paul to stop me or hint when I'm 5 minutes into it. So I want to thank the organizer. It's a very daring and interesting conference. It's, I feel a little off from most of you. I'm a social worker. I'm not a person of faith. I landed on studying this topic almost unintentionally. I'm originally from Israel. What I'm doing now is not, the PowerPoint at this moment is not one-on-one is what I'm saying. I found myself 25 years ago challenged by a student about whether congregation provides social services. Coming from Israel, European tradition, studied social work, I asked the stupid question, what church has to do with social services? This student kind of looked at me pitifully and took me to see a Baptist homeless shelter at the basement of a Baptist church. And then I went and started reading all the texts and all the books and all the articles I could find. And there was nothing in my profession, social work, written about anything that religion has to do with social services. That started a lifelong course of me, the most weird person, showing the rest of my colleagues that religion has a lot to do in social services. About 5 years ago, I was challenged by one of my students to do a study on Mormons. And I learned a lot about the Mormon culture, the Mormon people. And I find myself knowing a lot of things and correcting the perception of many people in my social and family circles. And I also did a study in 6 states across the country about the giving and volunteering habits of Mormons. I wanted to talk a lot about this study with you today, but that will not be the case. So Darius Gray, who's sitting here, sent me these beautiful comments from President Hinckley, and I planned to analyze the data that we have from almost 3,000 active Mormons and tell you in what way African-American Mormons are different from white Mormons. Well, we had a little problem. In the 6 states that we studied, and we studied every member who came that Sunday when we visited, in any of the words, we had so few African-Americans that we grouped all the others, the minorities, together. When I tried to dismantle it for this presentation, I found that the majority of the few minority that we have in this sample were actually mostly Latinos, African-borns, or others. So, while I wanted this to be the key themes of my presentation, I had to switch topic and talk about religion in general and the issue of race in America, of which I have a lot to say. So many of you heard about disestablishment. I don't think that for many of you in the audience I have to explain a lot of it, but in a simple way, this is what religiously separates us from the rest of the world, and especially from Europe. When I give my talks in Europe, if a clergy is sitting in the audience, there's a very good likelihood that he, sometimes she, is being paid by the state. That the building where we are sitting is financed by state money. We don't have it here. Since the disestablishment, and again, I know I have 20 minutes, so I won't explain it all, but I want to talk about two things that this establishment created that are very relevant for us today. First, you can start a place of worship in this country anytime, anywhere, and you don't need permission from anyone. You can do it in Canada. I admire Canada. My wife is from Canada. But if you want to open a place of worship there, you have to get permission from the states. If you want to lead one, you have to be somebody who graduated in accredited theological seminary. And the same goes for most places in Europe. You want to start a place of worship in this country? You do it. It also gave us many different faith communities in this country. It gave rise to the Church of the LDS Church and many other faith traditions. We are very active in our religiosity here. Now, in our studies, we separate between three types of congregation where people come to worship, places of worship: parish, congregation, and temple. Parish is a geographical location. In some faith tradition, if you live in this geographical area, you go to worship in this place. This is a most common and in some faith tradition. Congregation is a place where you decide where you go. You may have 20 congregations next to your house. You decide if you want one of them and one further. In a sociology of religion, we usually use the term, I drive past 10 churches before I reach my own church. You choose it. Catholic churches, Jewish Orthodox synagogues, and LDS words and branches are the last parish-oriented religious congregation in America. Question is, of course, and will be relevant in the next of my talk, who lives next to you? In one of the wards in Philadelphia that was part of my study, they cut, it's almost gerrymandering, they cut the wards in such a way that people from rich area will be with people from West Philadelphia, which is a poor area usually. In some places, it's more segregated. Temple is a term that we use, but is less American. It's much more, you find it in Asia. Some of you who are Mormons and may have done missionary there. People come to the place of worship when they feel like it. Major holiday, family events, family crisis, wanting spiritual consultation. There's no sense of group that always meet at a certain time, at a certain place, but it's more individually decided if you come and when you come. So the question that we always ask is, what better for integration, the parish or the congregation? I'll come back to it hopefully a little later. Many studies, including my studies, found that congregations are highly segregated. In my study, and corroborated with other study, 9 out of 10 congregations are ethnically segregated. The few that are not are culturally segregated. They're usually liberally oriented people, I'm talking both politically and socially, who are willing to put the work to overcome differences. Most people want to be in a place that is similar to them. I'm gonna use the next 2-3 minutes to tell you on a case in my research, and then I go to more research. When I did a study, my first study on congregation, I came to Indianapolis, and I've been to a beautiful congregation, Tabernacle Presbyterian Church, and they told me, beware, you're going to the heart of the black ghetto. Well, I don't know how many of you have been in Indianapolis, but what they call ghetto is not what the East Side called ghetto. But there was a beautiful campus of the church, all white members, over 1,000 families, very affluent, and a very charismatic and energized young pastor came to me and say, look, we do everything for the community. We have twice a week free medical clinic here. We have once a week free legal clinic here. We have 2 associate pastors that are doing baseball and basketball camps for the kids in the community because we have a diamond, baseball diamond, basketball court. None of them come to worship with us. I feel betrayed. What can we do? I told him, I told him, I don't know, but I have an advisory committee. I'll go and ask them. 2 weeks later, the advisory committee met. I told them about the progress in the study, what we're doing, and then I posed this question. One of the members of the advisory committee was a pastor from Long Island, black pastor from Long Island, looked me in the eye and said, go tell him he doesn't want them. I said, excuse me, but I can't. He said, listen to my story. He said, I have about 100 families of the richest people, black richest people, but also richest people in Long Island. They're people from Wall Street. They're making hundreds of thousands of dollars a year and more. When they come to church on Sunday, just what they wear is a $10,000. If you look at the jewelry, up. My associate pastor started talking with the driver, gardener, cooks, etc. And we want to bring them to church. They refused. We put pressure on some of them, and one Sunday, 4 families from the gardeners, cooks came to the room, and I'm almost quoting word for word what he said, where my member sat with the Kashmir suits, came in four men with JCPenney plastic suits that make noise when they did this, and everybody look and say, what in the world are they doing here? And those four families sat on one bench, one pew, and as soon as the sermon was over, ran out, never seen again. So I asked him, so what did you do? We rented another space, and every Sunday, my associate pastor hold a service for them. People in America, his words, don't want to worship with people who are not like themselves. They want to worship with people of the same ethnic group, same social class, same values, and this is America's choice. I didn't go back to tell this to the person in Indianapolis. So I did a study, a large study of congregations in Philadelphia. So it was a census of congregation. Took 3 years to carry out. We finally find out that in Philadelphia, because there are no list of congregation, if you want to find in any American city list of congregation, it's a mission impossible. We found about 2,100 congregation. We managed to go and interview about 1,400 of them, about two-thirds. We interviewed them, mostly clergies, for somewhere between 2.5 to 13 hours, depends on the congregation and their. So, on the one hand, our finding gave a wonderful picture about religion in America. This is from John Orr, that basically said, I'm now zooming. Okay. We found in Philadelphia, this is West Philadelphia, we found that there's more congregation in West Philadelphia than in anywhere else, any other organization in the city. I want to show you three maps quickly. Not a very good map, but this is Philadelphia. The darker it is, the more residents live, the more dots is where more congregation are. Not very smart. The next one is much more interesting. This is Latino congregation. The darker the green, the more Latino people live in it. The dots are the congregation. The congregation, and those, I don't need to tell you because you can make the connection, almost all of them are, there's a congregation that most of them have the majority of members Latinos. African American, the darker the blue, then higher the percentage of African American who live in the community, the dots are African American majority members. This is part of what we call voluntary segregation. People start their own congregation where they want it and make the culture and the environment of the congregation hospitable for the people who live there. So on the one hand, we talk about semi-voluntary association, places where people feel free, people, minority members can take leadership position, where people can help each other, and that's a wonderful thing. Given the time that I have, I'll summarize the rest of my presentation quickly. We compare black congregation to white congregations. I had another bottle of water that was open. What we found was black congregation on average are smaller in size than white congregations. They are having on average fewer resources, less. The building is of less quality and size. The budget is smaller. Now we know that when you have large number of members and you have higher budget, you are much more involved in social service deliveries. What we found in our comparison somewhat surprised us. African-American congregations, even though they are smaller in size, provide the same number of social programs as the counterpart. Some of the programs are more informal in nature, but they are major in the quality of life of people. So one way to look at it is to say, this is wonderful. Like-minded people freely congregate, worship together, and help their communities. And in both cases, the overwhelming majority of people who benefited from the congregational social services were non-members. It's not that they created programs to help us members. In almost three to six, it was helping others. Equal number. So the social involvement of African-American black congregation, even though the size is smaller, their income is smaller, doing well. The negative side of it, and I'm ignore this because I want to get to the last slide, is that congregations that are segregated are also perpetuating opportunity gap in our society. If people live in an area where the quality of education is unacceptable, and I can talk for about 20 minutes about West Philadelphia, and Tom can do the same, how the public education system failed the people who go to school there. And there is no opportunity for change and upward mobility. And I encourage you to read Robert Putnam's book, Our Kids. This voluntary segregation of congregations, which is held in the literature, which was very important in creating leaders in minority communities in America, is also a major source of perpetuating inequality in America today. I don't have answers. I'd love to hear it, what you have to say. If you want to write anything to me and engage in any conversation, this is why I rushed to the last slide. And if you took my picture, I want a copy of it. Thank you.
Right, thanks so much. It's great to be here. As the young people say, it's about to get real in here. let me make a connection. As you know, what I study is, as Nicole Hannah-Jones calls it, the problem we all live with, racial segregation. I want to do a twist on that and try to answer Dr. Cnaan's question about, can LDS congregations, can they be part of the solution? Is that possible? Have we seen it? And can we talk about it the rest of this conference? Can we make meaningful strides? All right, so why it happened are my hypotheses about why it happened, okay? And I want to talk to you about why it matters so much, the growth of the LDS Church in urban America. So here's the rundown. I like to always give you a plan and outline where I'm headed. I'll give you four hypotheses after I give you a little bit of background. I'll talk about the harvest of faith in Chicago, I'll talk about it in New York, two places where I've lived and seen it happen. I'll give you three case studies, time pending. We'll see how much time we have to spend on those. And then I want to end with why it matters. I want to show you the example of my four hypotheses in one person. I could have chosen other people, but I chose a public figure because, you know, I couldn't get the permission of just anybody, right? And then I'd like to give you just one slide at the end of implications, questions to consider in today's panel. Okay, so first of all, we're coming up on the 20-year anniversary in February, right, of 20 years of most members of the church not even being Americans, right? Not even being in the United States. However, the image of the church is very much rooted in a particular region and racial group within this country. Notwithstanding the fact that we're coming up on 20 years now, you see an absolute flip from 1980 to today, right? We've got the 42-58, 58-42, okay? So that's almost 9 million members. All the dark countries and states and provinces have temples. So you can see it proceeding across the globe, a globalizing church. And that matters a lot to what happens here in America. Okay, so I'm going to bookend this with the global church at the beginning and the end of my talk, and I hope you can get the point here. That matters a lot because America should be different. It should be a different country as a country of immigrants that we'll talk about here in a minute. So existing explanations, I'm just going to pick one and give you my understanding of it. I'm not a scholar of religion. I'm a scholar of race and housing and immigration. But Rodney Stark projected exponential growth in the church. And his main point was a lot of the world faiths, such as Islam, Catholicism, those world faiths were born a long time ago. And we can't collect data and observe what happened when they became world faiths. He says, but with Mormonism, it's happening now, and we can use, you know, social science methods to understand and make meaningful predictions about the future. So what were the reasons that he said the church grows fast? Well, we're in Utah, so let's talk about some of the Utah explanations, right? High birth rate and a volunteer missionary force, which you'd be surprised how important that is as a self-financing, self-sustaining, proselytizing kind of vehicle for a church to grow. Now, the two that I want to pick up with and run with and build on are these last two. One thing that he noted was migration and cultural continuity. People that have a faith tradition in Christianity are likely, when they pick up and go elsewhere, to continue that faith tradition. And he saw this studying many different settings. If you look at the country of Canada to our north, where does the LDS church grow fastest? In the most diverse open cities, okay, that are most open to people of different backgrounds and so forth, and immigrants and so on and so forth, okay? So this begins to open up kind of the sociological imagination for thinking about some ideas about this. A little more background. You can see that essentially what I'm trying to show here is that that segment of the donut that is light green and then darker green has grown. So the church has been growing more rapidly outside of the Mormon corridor than within the Mormon corridor. And that's important to understand because the fastest growing states in the United States during this period were Nevada, Arizona, and Utah, right? So those states are growing fast because people who are not Mormon, as well as Mormons, are moving to these areas, right, in the Sun Belt. But notwithstanding that fact, the LDS membership is growing even faster outside of the Mormon corridor, right? So now you see me going down, right? I'm starting at the world level. I'm going into the state level. Where am I going next? My students in the audience know where I'm headed, right? Now we're going to the metropolitan level, all right? So I just picked randomly, or was it randomly? Okay, 10 metros. Okay, you can see that Salt Lake and Provo, we got high growth rate, we've got a high population growth rate, we've got the secrets out about Salt Lake, right? It's majority non-LDS now. These places are growing quickly, but the LDS membership is growing even more quickly in across these other 10 metropolitan areas, right? And I've clumped them together to kind of make this obscure, so you guys have to guess here in a minute, okay? You can see that that growth rate is rising rapidly, and it really starts to pick up and take off here in the last 10 years in the data, right? And these are data that the church submits as part of a survey of congregations that all congregations throughout the United States submit their figures by county throughout the whole U.S. So which city do you think has grown fastest? The Metroplex, South Beach, Miami, Queens, or Philly, okay? Or your city, right? You know, you can always argue with me later, right? But I got the data from the from the secondary data set, all right? If you know the answer, don't you know, you keep it to yourself, okay? So we need to really think, you know, go back to what Lester Bush was talking about yesterday and think about Joseph Smith as a founder of the faith, as a visionary city planner. And when he planned cities, he said, you build a temple in the middle, you radiate out there, and then you do the gated subdivisions. Wait a minute. You don't do that, right? And you do the streets that are all curvy and change names. No, you don't do that either. You keep a grid like New York, Salt Lake, Philadelphia, right? Those cities have a lot in common, right? And today, Salt Lake City is rated the most efficient street grid in America, right? And it was visionary that they had these wide streets way before automobiles, right, were invented, okay? The point was, it was an urban church, urban planning, urban communities, an urban future in terms of, right? There's a commandment about how we're supposed to live, Zion society, right? It's not like this is all just, you know, made up. And the temple was at the center. And what do you see in the announcements about the temples today? Kansas City, Philadelphia, Provo City, right? All those are within the city limits, right? So we're moving back from the whole privileged suburban temple siting, okay, back to the city. Now, why are we doing that? Let's talk about that. So why has the church grown so fast? Now, obvious point, right? I'm at this conference. We're not going to, you know, skip over this, right? The 1978 lifting of the temple and priesthood restriction was key. But as a scholar of race and space and fellow scholars here to my left, that's not enough, right? That's not going to explain variation across different places. What's really going to be more important is the concept of segregation, right? So there's a commandment those who are LDS know about sharing to your neighbor. Well, I don't care how much you shared. Back in 1980, right, about 9 in 10 of the neighbors of white people, right, were other white people, okay? America is highly segregated. It's still very segregated, especially in these cities that I'm showing here. And that is a reality that a lot of people, when they think about race and the church, they don't think about the within-country effect of segregation. They think about people that are of a different race in other countries and that they're separate, but really what we have in the United States, especially in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, is this architecture of extreme segregation. Detroit and Chicago had segregation levels that were 90 out of 100, right? Almost total segregation. This means that entire communities, contiguous communities, had no previous contact, and that when things began to change, that was like opening up a whole new country within a country, all right, as far as the LDS growth is talking about, right? There was a meeting, right, held in the South Side of Chicago, and the mission president was there, right, in 1980, saying millions of doors have never been knocked. So this is the paradox of LDS integration that I want you guys to maybe put an asterisk in your notes and think about. The church in this place, right, one of the most segregated places in America, could become and had that potential to be one of the most integrated institutions, not just for black Americans, but also for white Americans, right? Those who came to go to graduate school would have had a segregated experience, mostly with all white people, had it not been for their involvement in the church, right? And thinking about how we make that meaningful is kind of the challenge that I have, okay? So I grew up, as part of this story here, in the 1980s. We lived there from the late 1970s, moved in the summer of the Revelation, lived there till the 1990s. My school was predominantly black, scout troop predominantly black. A lot of the leadership was predominantly black. So when I looked up on the stand, I saw black leaders. And this had a profound effect on me as a person. I think that this type of integration can have a profound effect in the future. And like I said in the Black History Month thing, right, what if all white kids grew up with a black Santa Claus, right? I mean, that would make a big difference, right? Seeing all the source of goodness and gifts coming from a black person, right? Right? You remember that. But the point is segregation shapes the experience right from childhood, and that when, I'm going to get to this at the end, when students get to BYU or college level, right, it's a little late, right, for people to finally be, you know, waking up and knowing what time it is, as they say, right? So we know that all the housing projects in Chicago have been dismantled, and that today we have a different city. And so you should always question, right, like Robert Putnam does in his work, go back and count, right? So I said, all right, I'm going to follow Putnam. I went back and counted. And what did I see on August 23rd, 2015? Two very racially integrated congregations. We had a youth speaker, African-American, gave a great talk and mentioned her older brother on his mission in Mississippi. We had a white male who was a convert who gave another talk, and then we had an Asian-American high counselor give the third talk, right? And I saw the people intermingle. I made my own estimates, right, based on visual inspection, right? And so integration remains, okay? And there's been a lot of ups and downs, of course, in the story in between. All right, so here's two reasons. Let's get to the third one. So we got the rise of young singles. You see this centered first off and primarily, right, in the colonial wards in D.C., in all the wards in New York, and in these post-industrial cities. If you look carefully at this picture, right, it strikes you as white, but if you look more carefully, about half of the people there are Latino, Asian American, African American. Okay, this is more multiracial, it's more highly educated, and it's much more equal than it was in our grandparents' age between men and women, that the men and women are more likely to be working in more equal occupations and marrying at later ages. And so, you know, you can be cynical and call this a Friends or a Seinfeld effect, you know, that it's cool for white people to live in cities again, and no doubt that has an impact, but this has already gained its own momentum where the social networks are in place and people are moving to cities. You can see in New York there are two very large singles wards there, among many other types of units, a Chinese ward and a sign language branch of note. You can see here in New York City, the stake president, he used to do his own PowerPoints, President Belknap, right, and pointed out that the majority of members are singles, right? So when you go to church, right, there's fewer babies crying, and it's a different experience. And you can see here that that fueled a quadrupling in the growth of the church, okay, over this time period. So there's been phenomenal growth here in the heart of New York. And this is true in other societies. We don't have time to watch this video, but if you look up Ness, the divorced young woman in London who lives in the kind of area that was war-torn by the riots in the past, she's part of this gentrification, has a very diverse network of friends, okay? So immigration is the fourth, and I think one of the most important reasons that's risen in importance over time. I'd like those who are immigrants to raise your hand, those who are immigrants to the U.S., those who are children of immigrants, okay, a few more hands. Okay, so this is getting pretty close to the proportion of the population of the U.S. is 25% immigrants or children of immigrants today. You can see the Latino population has risen dramatically to over 55 million. And something people don't talk about and don't think about is that in 1970, 1 out of 100 blacks was an immigrant, and today it's 1 out of 11. Okay, that's 1 out of 100 to 1 out of 11. And those of you who are from the East know that that is not distributedly, as we talked about earlier, randomly across the landscape. That is concentrated on the East Coast. Okay, so you can see that in our doctrine, and one of the things that we try to instill in the young people that we teach at BYU is that this is a core part of their belief and value system, that it says, whatsoever nation, right? Doesn't say one or the other, okay? And you can see increasing growth nationwide, and the Latino population growth now, if you put up a wall like some people want to do, foolishly, you would still have tremendous population growth because the growth is due to natural increase by more births than deaths. It's not due to immigration anymore because of the age structure of the population. So black immigration is more on the East Coast, and Latino immigration is more nationwide. You can see this in the data, tremendous increase here, nearly a quadrupling, certainly by today in 2015, in the number of Spanish-speaking congregations, okay? And that's a proxy, of course, for kind of the first generation immigrants, even if the young people, right, are playing video games and basketball and not speaking Spanish, right? So let's look at, let's start to, all right, examine the data, okay? I've given you my story, let's look at the data. 1980, we only had one chapel in the whole city of Chicago, third largest city in the United States. You can see a big shift toward Latino population, black and the white population has gone down. And what do we have today, right? We have a tremendous increase in the church in this area. And Chicago was not even in my list, right, of the fastest growing places. Okay, so I'm just warming up. Harlem, I saw a similar process in the 2000s. A lot of the, we had a very large family that joined the church. The father was African American and his wife was from Honduras. And we had a lot of immigrants from Central America as well as the Caribbean and elsewhere. A lot of these young people found a lot of support, like connecting to Dr. Cnaan's talk, in helping them write their college applications, being first generation college students. And these little things, these connections, by having meaningful integration, really made all the difference in their lives today. They're college graduates, they're successful people. There's, you know, church markers that you can use in terms of going on missions and being sealed in the temple. But more than anything, their standard of living is dramatically different today, and they're in very racially integrated environments. You can see them there at BYU, Idaho. Look like a lot of fun. And so these were the times, right? And you could see the growth, and you could see people working together with a meaningful goal, in our case, to get out of a building with no windows, right, where you had to have primary in the basement in the hallway. When we had a meaningful goal and worked together, that created a kind of lifelong bond across social class, education, and race. Three case studies, real quick. I got time, right, Paul?
Yes.
Okay? All right. Perfect. Miami, you can see, perhaps we'll guess Miami, because when you go there, it's more like Latin America, and we know the church is growing fast in Latin America. And you can see here, boom, 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 right? Spanish-speaking congregations. And you can see a different type of ideology emerging with this stake president feeling like diversity is the divine potential, right, of the church, and that that is kind of the end goal and the kind of guiding lodestar, okay? You can see here tremendous growth across all decades. Queens, New York, always, you know, fighting with Los Angeles and London to be the most multicultural place on the earth. I think it's got the title right now. You can see an equal representation of all major and racial ethnic groups. And actually, the income and education of the black population is slightly higher than that of the white population due to the tremendous increase in immigration from the Caribbean. And here you see units, Chinese ward, Korean branch, Spanish-speaking units, and a YSA unit, okay? And actually, this has changed since the first time I gave this talk. It used to be one stake, and then it's two stakes. And you can see most of the increase in the membership in Queens follows this path of immigration since 1990, right? Unlike the Miami case, almost all of this growth is since 1990. All right, if you guess Philadelphia, all right, go get a cookie or something after, because you earned it. You can see a 32-fold increase here in the region in the growth of the church, a highly segregated area. We have lots of people who've been on the front lines of the growth of the church there, and you can see a tremendous increase, proportionately speaking, in immigration. This is a big uptick. Philadelphia reclaiming the crown as an immigrant gateway, its heritage, and you can see here almost all of that growth is concentrated in the last 10 years, which is pretty impressive from a growth standpoint. So this is at the top of the data set, the fastest growing, right, county in the U.S., right? So what explains this, right? So I know somebody that was a high counselor in South Philadelphia for a long time. And based on what they said, you know, I started looking at the data in terms of immigration from West Africa. But we know this is a region of the globe where the church is growing rapidly. And in fact, you can see almost a tripling of the population of West Africans in Philadelphia. So let's look at West Africa. And what do we see? In Ghana, we see a tremendous increase. And when we overlay it with Philadelphia, we see almost the same pattern. Okay? Are people using Facebook and Twitter? Are people flying on more low-cost airlines than they were in the 1970s? Absolutely, right? We're in a more integrated, globalized world. To understand the growth of the church in the United States, we need to think globally and how that connects with the growth of the church globally. And there's a connection there in Philadelphia, okay? So to summarize, race and segregation are very important. The rise of young singles is something else, especially since the 90s. Part of my own experience, my wife and I met in New York as singles. And immigration, I think, is increasing and really becoming the leading explanation to understand the variation in growth across time and across places. So let me show you an example of why it matters. Jabari Parker, I'll just sum up. Let's just quote what he said, right? So when he was asked by Katie Couric, right, do people think that's weird, you're Mormon? He said, yeah, they do, right? He said most of the time when people think of Mormons, they would look at a white guy, right? They would think about, right, Mitt Romney, the Book of Mormon musical or what have you. Even Marie Osmond is left out now by the young people because they're too young to know who she is, right? It's almost all white males. And that is, and so we got to abstract just out of doing good PR, because we do great PR as a church, and thinking about the social construction of Mormonism, right? How is that going to be reconstructed in the popular imagination, right? And he's an example of somebody that embodies all four, right? Race, segregation, right? Going to a segregated high school, Simeon, but going to an integrated congregation. Immigration, we know that, right? His mother, right? That her grandfather is one of the first converts in Tonga. And now, he's gotten older, right? He's a young single now, too. Okay? So you can see all the hypotheses embodied in one person, right? And this is just to get the wheels turning to think about, you know, if people like this could be on TV, right, and could start to change the way people think about it, imagine what could follow, okay? So you can see this potential to shift the social construction of Mormonism, and I think that's why it's important, right, beyond basketball, okay? And I could have picked, you know, those who are amazing black intellectuals. I could have picked another sphere of life to make this point, right? I'm just picking a public figure. So what are the implications? Well, first of all, brings us a lot of relief to say that Black Lives Matter. Let's just say that. What is the role of race, space, and immigration in your area? I really want to hear about the rest of the day, the rest of this conference. I hope we can continue this dialogue. How does this overlap with gender, social class, single status? What is meaningful LDS racial integration? Let me tell you what it's not. It's not that students of color come to BYU and have no idea that Joseph Smith ordained people of color. They have no idea about J. Manning James. That is not meaningful integration, okay? It is not meaningful integration when people who are multiracial, and about one-third of the black students are multiracial at BYU, and the multiracial Asian students, Latino students, feel like they need to conform to a white frame and become white to be accepted. That is not meaningful racial integration. That is an artifact of the past. Of assimilation. We have a new era. We should value multiculturalism, and we should think about not just kumbaya, we all sit around and hold hands, but material benefits, right? I just wrote down three. Putting people in leadership positions, like we saw in Chicago, having meaningful interaction, and integrating social networks, which we know is one of the most segregated things, right, that perpetuates inequality in jobs and schooling, right? All of those things are material benefits, and changing the frame, right, that white racial frame that people use in the white dominant population, that's a big, major, tangible thing that should be an outcome of meaningful integration, that white people begin to see racism as a systematic, right, systemic pattern and understand that we need to change laws and institutions, right, and not just hearts and minds. And do our young people understand this? If they don't, we need to start to integrate it in the curriculum. We need to start to integrate it into our discussions. My daughter knows about the Virginia colony. She knows about people carrying freedom papers. She knows about this and that. And she knows more than I do about a few subjects, I can tell you. And we need to cultivate, we need it to be just as important as sharing our testimony, talking about race with our young people. So can we alter the social construction of Mormonism? That's my challenge for the rest of the panel participants. Thank you.
Thank you to each of our panelists for a very stimulating session. We will take questions. Let me just remind you of the guidelines for questions from last night. Number one, keep your questions short and to the point, no discourses. We know what happened in some of Brigham Young's discourses. We don't need any more discourses. And number two, loosen your grip on the microphone once you're done and pass it back to the aisle, okay? So the Tanner Humanities staff will facilitate this, and we will plan to start our next panel on time at 10:15, so we'll take questions for just a little bit and take a short break, and then we'll be back on schedule.
Can we get your slides?
Absolutely.
Thank
yep.
you.
Just email me, and I'll also make them available through this dissemination of the proceedings of the conference.
This is for Professor Rugh. I guess it's a two-part question. How much of the growth for the church in Utah is due to white Mormon members migrating here? And two, could that be significant because of the diversity of the church outside of Utah?
I'm not sure about the second part of your question, but the first part, certainly, yeah. Utah is a fast-growing state, and it has a high birth rate, so that's certainly true. But also the story that I told you about immigration, right, we don't want to just always isolate Utah and say, well, Utah's all white. That's certainly not true. You go here to, you know, West Valley City, Rose Park, these are majority-minority communities. They're growing rapidly through some of the same forces of really rapid Latino immigration, and now we have incorporation of refugees from all over the globe. Salt Lake City is a model city. So I see all the forces here. We know that in Utah County, I mean, you just, the market is saturated, right? All the white people are Mormon already. So who are the leading, I mean, I'm being facetious, but it's, demographically speaking, it's true. We know that most of the converts to the LDS Church in Utah County are Latino. We just know that from the data. And so I think a lot of this still maps onto the Utah thing. Obviously, you still always have those background trends of the continued white growth.
So my question, Lori, is I have a sister that's in Riverside, Utah, California, mm-hmm. and their stakes have reduced. So they've gone from three states
Good. I'm glad you mentioned California. So what happened with California, I'll sum up really quickly. Orange County was a site of white flight for many decades. And then there are no counties that are the white flight counties anymore, right? Where are the counties of white flight in California? Not in California, right? Kind of like New Jersey's two biggest cities are not New Jersey, right? They're all outside, and you're right. And a lot of these white people are older, and they left, right, when brown people started to come, and there's a connection there. And that's certainly true. That has fueled among the older population segment, I would say, more so. I think that's diminishing over time, but certainly Arizona and Utah are white flight destinations for a lot of Californians. Mm-hmm.
Hi, my question is for Rom and for Jacob. So considering that the LDS Church is a parish-based religion, and considering that people are tribal, and this is not an apostolic, this is not an apostasy-based question, so don't be afraid. I just want to make that clear. My question is, considering these two points, would it be more beneficial for the LDS Church to become a congregation-based church in order to generate more unity and less separation within the church? And would that be the means to bring about the diversity that is needed? Does that make sense?
That makes sense. I mean, I think you can still maintain a parish-based, geographically fixed thing and just draw things differently to still promote integration.
So,
I'd like to hear how.
Okay. One thing that the LDS Church has in its advantage and other faith traditions don't have is that every Sunday, the exact same text and the exact same content is being delivered. I don't have a better word, but you know what I mean. No matter where you are in the world. Whereas other faith tradition, there are local alteration, variation, and preferences. So it'll be easier for the LDS Church. I don't know, I'm not smart enough to tell you if congregation is the answer. But redistricting words in a way, and the one word in West Philadelphia that I'm very familiar with, they basically cut the lines that go through a very affluent suburb all the way to basically the university and a little past the university. So I've visited this place at least four or five times in the last 3 years, and every time I come, people sit in the pews of all faith tradition. We don't have Ghanaian, it's not me. They don't have Ghanaian, they have many Liberian. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if it'll be the same graph going on. But that kind of things, that same people come every Sunday and they start integrating with each other. And most importantly is the same message and the same type of Sunday service that they get every place is a strength of the LDS Church that can be used if taking real action to integrate the church.
I can add one point on this, which grows out of my studies of segregation and religious institutions, especially parishes, but also all sorts of other ways that we divide up space in the United States. Mm-hmm. Boundaries matter, because they determine who is in and who is out. And where boundaries are drawn, as both these cases make crystal clear, determines whether or not a parish-type institution is integrative or reinforces patterns of segregation. And the exciting possibility that I'm hearing from both of these studies and in different places is the power of drawing ward boundaries in a way that opens up the possibilities for bringing people together who might not be living in the same schools or socializing in other ways in everyday life. And this can be a powerful tool for breaking down some of those barriers.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think we have time for one more question.
I'm loud, so
Beth has a microphone right here, LaShawn.
Get recorded.
Just to add to what you were asking, Alice, I'm wondering how our language wards impact this inability for us to integrate, because the only ethnic groups that do not necessarily get a language word are African Americans, black people in the United States. So it's really us, and it turns into that black-white binary when we are in our wards, because we're the only ones that do not have a language ward. Our other ethnic groups have language wards, and so when there's enough of them around, they get a language ward thing. And so because we don't have that, when we have Genesis, which is once a month and fantastic, however, the language ward seems to be what is impacting our inability to integrate appropriately. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying that I would love a language ward, but I kind of would love one just for black folk. And if we need to translate some stuff urbanly into to get it, you know, into our literature, I'm down for that, because there's benefit and it helps. And then that's where you get people across demographic boundaries coming together because they share language. And that might put us into a whole another conversation, but I'm willing to have it all day.
Yeah, let me just follow up, LaShawn, real quick. I think in Chicago, what the leadership, and I think it was genuine leadership, tried to do was make that possible and also have white people there, but have blacks really running the show, doing the thing, and being the role models, and having an influence, right? Not being tokens, right? And so I think that's the best, that's the ideal, right? I think in the future with the Latino population, what you're going to see is that all these young people coming of age, they're going to start to outnumber their parents and grandparents. And they're not speaking Spanish, right? And so that is going to be a good bridge that we have through that Latino bridge. And Ignacio Garcia would agree with me. I think that's going to be a good bridge for white people to finally kind of get with the program here, right, and integrate meaningfully with blacks as well, kind of a bridge to that. I hope so.
I was, in preparation for this presentation, I was looking for black branches. And I was told by some of my sources that there's one in California. No, it's in Florida. I couldn't find it. But everybody I talked with said there is one. And personally, as a non-member of the church, I'd love to know about it and maybe talk with people there and see whether it's enhancing or the opposite. Because every member that I talk with otherwise say, we are integrated. So everybody who comes to ward is an equal member. And when I go to visit, they say, look, some minority people here, some there, they're well integrated. I don't know if this is the case. Okay, I don't know, because it's not something I study, and I'm just an observer.
Thank you. One last point to add on to this is that here I think the Mormons have a lot to learn from the Catholic Church, one of the other parish-based denominations. And during the period of enormous European, Southern and Eastern European immigration to the United States, the Catholic Church set up ethnic parishes, which were a bit like linguistically organized. Mm-hmm. And it was said in the 1920s, when these parishes were at their peak, that a marriage between a Polish Catholic and an Italian Catholic was a mixed marriage, because they were attending separate linguistically and culturally parishes, even if they had the same texts, the same order of service every weekend, every Sunday. That changed, and it changed as a result of the process of the shift from first to second to third generation, and where the Catholic Church succeeded. It was reorganizing the institution to reflect that second and third generation transformation. Mm-hmm. Ethnic parishes began to disappear as a way of setting up a system where Polish and Italians marrying together was perfectly normal, not something that was exceptional. But that took institutional transformation, and that happened over time.
Just one word to add to what Tom said. When they tried to close some congregations and merge them, there was major resistance by members, especially in Boston, in Philadelphia, and other big cities, when they realized they don't have enough people in the parish to sustain a separate church. They said, okay, instead of church of Agatha and a church of this, let's put it together. And many members decided, okay, you ask us to go to the parish model. We now start driving, like the Protestant, to other places, because I'm not going to go to the same service with the people from another country, which is neighboring country in Europe. So there are pros and cons, and it's hard to tell which one is the best.
I'm just going to, as a Utah historian, remind people here that in the 19th century, the language-based churches were white Scandinavian language-based churches that disappeared by the 1930s after that generational language assimilation process. Absolutely. So I have to cut it. We need to thank these panelists for a fabulous panel.
Thank you.